the Skywatcher Evostar 80ED doublet refracting telescope. Solid entry into the range by Skywatcher, and I've had the pleasure of using this telescope now for about 7 months. My name is Razin Farsev, and you're watching AstroFarsography, and today we're going to review this telescope in case you're thinking about buying one. 80mm aperture, 600mm focal length, making this telescope natively f7.5. While sight isn't really slow by anyone's measure, for deep sky work, you begin to get away from where you want to be. What you could do is buy the dedicated reducer flattener from Skywatcher for the Evostar 80ED, which reduces the focal length of your scope by 0.85 times. That then makes this telescope f6.3, so we're reining it back in a little bit. Or you could buy another reducer flattener like I did, which was the Altair Lightwave 0.8 times reducer flattener, which makes this f6, which is exactly half a stop slower. That then becomes 80mm aperture and 420mm focal length. One thing about Skywatcher and the Evostar series is they don't disclose what glass is in these telescopes. All they'll say is that the glass on the 72ED is different than the 80, 102, and the 72 has different, the Evostar 72ED has different glass than the rest of the Evostar ED range. I've heard from a source that is FPL 53, which is almost basically the glass you really want, but I can't understand that if they have got 53 glass on this telescope, why they don't boast about it, especially at this price point, because the Evostar 80 is very well priced, in my opinion. As mentioned, this is a refracting telescope, which means it uses glass lenses at the front to pull the light to the rear, rather than using a mirror or a combination of the two like Newtonians or Schmidt-Cassegrain telescopes. Being a doublet, as the name implies, there's two glass lenses at the front here, and the front being the crown element is what's called extra dispersion, ED. In English, that means it pulls the light waves to a better point and focuses them better, removing what's called chromatic aberration, which is something that you don't want. So when you're buying a refracting telescope, you really want to look out for extra dispersion, ED glass. At the back is an 11:1 dual speed focuser. At this point, you would expect nothing other than dual speed. So you've got a fine control knob here and your coarse control here. 11:1 ratio. And I find it's really quite smooth, quite silky smooth. There's a lot of feedback in this control. You can tell it's got good kinetic feedback to it. It doesn't feel heavy, but you can definitely feel that you're moving the rack, especially once you've got your camera gear on the back of it, if you're imaging with it, but it still doesn't feel heavy. On the bottom of the rack, you of course have a focus lock screw, so you can just tighten that in. Don't wrench it, but tighten it just enough and it'll hold the focus steady. I've had this telescope pointing directly up with my hypercam hanging off the back of it and it hasn't slipped focus. So the little screw that holds the focus in lock works just fine for normal imaging purposes, including the DSLR. I've had that hanging off the back as well, just fine. The tube of this telescope is what they call the black diamond finish. It's basically black with silver pearlescent flake in it. It looks quite nice for sure. Weighs about 3 kilograms. The actual feel of it is good. The build quality feels nice and sturdy. The fixtures and fittings feel good. The dew shield is a hefty bit of metal up the front encompassing the lenses, so it's not retractable and not really removable because the glass elements are in the dew shield itself. So you would put your dew band here. It's good, it helps with balancing, but we'll get onto that in a minute. The tube itself doesn't feel like some really thin bit of metal. The plastics, while they feel plastic, they don't feel cheap plastic. The main criticism I have with it is the tube rings itself have a lot of slop in them. But honestly, that's not really the end of the world. It's not a deal breaker, especially once it's clamped down, they don't move. The first issue I immediately encountered when I had this telescope when I got it in December was balancing and the dovetail. You'll notice on my version, I've actually got an aftermarket ADM dovetail on this. And that's because I could not balance in declination. The green one that came with it, very pretty, looks very nice. It was very nicely finished, but Whilst it'll probably be perfect for visual use, by the time I'd put my DSLR on the back of it, my gyroscope was in the finder shoe. This was all the way forward in the rings, in the dovetail, on the puck. I still couldn't get declination balance. So really, you'd have to either piggyback your gyroscope if you're guiding, or maybe use an off-axis guider. I don't know how that would affect it. Or do what I did and just factor in the cost of a longer dovetail. One thing that Skywatcher seem to do on all their telescopes is this. I can only assume it's to screw your camera on. There's a quarter inch threaded UNC bolt in the back with this standoff on it. And like I said, I believe it's to piggyback your camera on. However, I've never been able to get that to work by directly screwing the camera on. I think I had it work once with a 450D, but it felt horrible. It was so tight. It felt like I was about to break something. And while you're messing around with this screw, it can come a bit loose. It can unthread itself slightly. And then while you're moving the scope in the tube rings and rotating it, trying to get it to balance and stuff, it's going to come down just slightly enough to touch the body and scratch your paintwork up. So what I'd recommend doing is just buy a ball head off of eBay or something. Like, just get yourself a ball head and screw that on. As long as it's got the UNC thread, which is a standard tripod thread, you'll be able to fit a ball head on there. If you really want to piggyback a DSLR on the back of it, do that instead. Or just remove it and save your paintwork. I'll pass that on, as mine is now scratched up and I'm very upset about it. Very upset about it. Now, the Evostar series all come with an aluminium storage case. And while it's all nice and well, the foam inserts are held in with the smallest bit of what looks like hot glue or PVA glue onto a very small bit of corrugated cardboard. Whilst the outside of the case feels a bit cheap and flimsy in a way, it still feels quite sturdy. And I would have faith that my telescope inside would survive the impact, but I still don't know how I'd feel about having my telescope in that kind of impact. If you're going to be putting this on a plane or something, I feel like this flight case, I believe they call them flight cases, would protect your telescope. The flight case also come with these tiny keys. Now, they're also nice that they're included, obviously, it's for locking your case, but they are sturdy. I can't exactly bend them, but to me, they still look like they're just waiting to break off in the lock. Obviously, you won't be wrenching it like you're opening your front door, but I don't know how comfortable I would be trusting these keys. The finder's shoe sits at 10 o'clock. Now, we're going back to balance again one more time here. This is the final time I'm going to talk about balance. The finder shoe sits at 10 o'clock. So even if you manage to change your dovetail, get a nice long dovetail like I've got on this one, and reach declination balance, you're never going to truly be balanced because the weight is off center. The center of mass is off the middle. What you can do with that, is quite simply undo the tube rings and move the telescope until the finder shoe is at the 12 o'clock position. Obviously, you then forsake piggybacking a DSLR because you need your gyroscope there, but to be honest, which is more important to you? Or you could piggyback your gyroscope. Now, I subscribe to the premise that no one telescope can do it all, and that is no exception with the ATED here. Yes, you could put a 3x Barlow on it, use a small chip camera, and then look at try and image Jupiter, but then you'll be at f22.5 before you even take into account the crop factor of the camera that you are. If it's a small chip camera like an ASI 120, I believe they have a 7x crop factor. I think they're 7x smaller. So yeah, beware of that. Even if you get that working, you're not going to see the detail that you'd be hoping for in those kind of targets just because you don't have the aperture to resolve it. So I'd stay away from planetary imaging with an Evostar ATED. I'd say either get the big ones, like the 150s, but they're very expensive, or get a large Newtonian. I recommend the ATED be turned to mid to large size deep sky targets. With a crop body DSLR camera like a 1.5 crop factor Nikon or a 1.6 crop factor body Canon like the 450 or 600Ds, teamed with the 0.8 times reducer or even the 0.85 times reducer flattener on the back, you'll be able to fit targets like the Rosette Nebula, M31 Andromeda Galaxy, and even the Lagoon and Trifid Nebula into one field of view. It's quite a large field of view, so it's very versatile for you. And I think that's what this telescope excels at. As for dedicated cameras, the focal length of this, whether you reduce it or not, works perfectly with the 183 sensor. The suitability, the pixels on that sensor work wonderfully with this. You don't get undersampling or oversampling. It's a much tighter field of view though, because it's a very small sensor size. So take that into consideration if you're gonna buy this telescope and you're using a DSLR now, but you think you're gonna upgrade to like a 183C or M, just double check with that, because I didn't, and I kind of got caught out with that. As for other cameras, the popular 1600 series works nice as well. It's quite suitable for this telescope. The pixel size, again, suitable. The popular 294 color sensors, however, whilst they match up, they are very close to undersampling, which is not as bad as oversampling, but just to make you aware, you're getting towards the end of the scale on that one. All in all, I think Skywatcher has made a very good and versatile telescope in the Evostar 80ED. If you're using it for imaging, be sure to factor in the cost for the reducer flattener and possibly a longer dovetail if you haven't got a piggyback guide solution. If you're not guiding at this point, then don't really worry about it, but just bear that in mind that I needed a longer dovetail and you may need to as well. Pair it with a DSLR and you're going to be happy. I don't know what the image circle is like for a full frame, but judging by it's a 2-inch focuser on it, I think a full frame camera would also work nicely on it with no vignetting, but I can't confirm that. But yeah, team it with a crop factor DSLR, you're going to be happy. If you're going to put a dedicated camera on it, just go to Stellarium or Telescopius or something and just check the field of view you're going to get before you buy it and don't get caught out on it. The ATED is good for nebula and galaxies, medium to large. Not very good for planets. And as I already mentioned, the case is serviceable, but nothing special, but will protect the telescope. I feel comfortable recommending this telescope. If you're looking at it and you're doing the research right now and looking for reviews on it, and you know what kind of field of view, you've checked that out and you're happy with all that, I do feel comfortable recommending this telescope. I feel good for beginners and veterans alike. It's got a forgiving field of view for people newer to the hobby, where it's not as demanding. If you've got a DSLR on it, it's not as demanding on your guiding because the shorter field of view. And for more intermediate and advanced users, then it's got that versatile range on it as well. So if you put a DSLR in it, you're happy. If you put a dedicated camera on it, you're happy. You know where you stand. The color correction on this telescope has been spot on. I've not noticed any chromatic aberration, even on bright stars. I took a picture of Vega with it just quickly as a test image. I don't have the picture to hand, but I took Vega and I still saw no chromatic aberration around it. That was using a L Pro Max filter in the drivetrain, but that's not going to compensate for chromatic aberration. If you've got a go-to tracking mount, you've got a DSLR and you're looking for a telescope ready for those winter targets, then you can't really go wrong with the 80ED. But also look at the 72ED. But if you're going to get one telescope for nebulas and galaxies in winter especially, you can't really go wrong with an 80ED. Thanks very much for watching. If you liked it, leave a thumbs up. If you didn't like it, leave a thumbs down. Drop a comment, tell me what you think. If you think about buying one, hope this has been helpful to you. And if you're interested in this kind of stuff, consider subscribing to AstroFarsography. Thanks very much. I hope you have a great day, clear skies, and all the best fortunes upon you. See you later.